In the complete discography of Arthur Rubinstein, the list of one composer's works is longer than that of any other, and I imagine it will be no surprise to anyone to hear that the composer in question is Chopin. On the occasion of the release of a new RCA Victor album of 14 Chopin waltzes, we are talking with Mr. Rubinstein about the very close association he has had with the works of Chopin over the many years of his career. I think perhaps the first question, Mr. Rubinstein, is why? Why this identification with one man?
You see, Chopin has a peculiar name in music. He was born in Poland from a French father and a very Polish mother. His French father came as a very young boy to Poland, fought in the Polish revolution against Russia, and fought in the Napoleonic times. Chopin was born in 1810. When his father married, he was a teacher of French. He was a sort of private teacher of French in an aristocratic house near Warsaw. And he married there a poor relation who was there also a kind of governess. Justyna Krzyżanowska, a very, very Polish lady, I mean, of pure Polish blood. Well, Chopin was, of course, a super Pole when it comes to his feelings for music. He took most of his genius out of the folkloric Polish life, which is very rich. A friend of Chopin has published, before he died, 48 volumes of folklore songs which he had gathered. So you can imagine what a wealth of that is. I'm going far back because it's interesting.
Yes, absolutely. Please go right ahead.
Chopin, having a little of the Gallic blood in him too, from his father, who became completely Polish, living there and becoming professor of the Warsaw University and so on and so forth, having a pension for young students, which were mostly aristocrats, which gave Frederick Chopin, you know, this aristocratic approach to life, this supreme elegance, this refinement of manners, and manners in, musically speaking too. All that is very, very typical. Well, the musicians of his time didn't quite understand the whole importance of that man. He wrote only for the piano, exception made for some orchestral thing with the piano, of course, where the piano is a concertizing element, and a sonata for cello for a friend, which was not very successful, and the trio, which was even less successful because his friend was a cellist in France. He devoted all his life to the piano. So we pianists consider him as our supreme god of the piano. He has much more to do with the piano than any other composer.
So that would be one point of reference. He was a pianist's composer. Do you and he share a point of view in other ways?
Now comes the point of his music, which is based so very much on the Polish folklore. I am a Pole too, by birth. For me, the same origin, the same folkloric origin of Polish music lives in my bones. It doesn't cost me. I don't need to think about it. I don't need to consider what the rhythm might be or something, because it is absolutely natural to me, like the accent of my language, like breathing. So, of course, Polish pianists are better equipped for performances of Chopin's music than any other pianist. And that goes simply naturally. That is not a privilege we are assuming or something like that, but which is in the natural way of Chopin's work, as I explained it. I don't know if I made myself clear.
Yes, of course. It's the most natural thing in the world by birth. Polish by inclination, he favored the piano. It fits perfectly. I understand he was quite a performer, too, and a teacher of piano. At least he was always dedicating pieces to his piano students. The C-sharp minor, I believe, was dedicated to Madame Rothschild, who was a pupil.
Well, yes, he used to dedicate it. Well, she's a proud woman who had also the ballade in F minor, which is the finest of the four, dedicated to her too. By far more of a homage to her than the waltz. The waltz is very lovely, but the ballade is most important. Mm-hmm. He must have had quite a feeling for her if he dedicated her that ballade.
Are you hinting at something, Mr. Rubinstein? A special kind of feeling?
Well, I don't know. You know that piano teachers are always very dangerous to his pupils. It's a famous thing. It's always a historic, you know, in many novels, you know, the parents are always scared to death of a piano teacher because he has a natural sentimental approach to a young girl or to a young pupil. You know, he can tell her about his heart and about love and about all sorts of things, of course, musically. And that has mostly a great effect on teenagers. So we are dangerous for teenagers.
I hope you haven't started something here that'll have all the piano teachers down on my neck when they lose their impressionable students. In his notes to your RCA Victor album of Chopin waltzes, Mr. Rubinstein, Herbert Weinstock hints that you have a favorite among the 14.
A favorite? No, I would say he must have made a mistake about speaking of favorites. No, but there are characteristic ones, which of course, whenever we have a point of some literary link, you know, and there's a story behind something, we can't resist it. You know that as well as I do. We can't resist if we know, oh yes, he has written that piece for his mother on her birthday, or that was a thing where he was disappointed in love, or that was when he was seated on a bench waiting for his lover on the moonshine at night, you know, moonshining on him. I mean, all that sort of, we like it. Well, the waltzes are the ones where we can trace all sort of literary stories behind. But this, for instance, the one which he has written for the Countess Delphine Potocka. And he made her laugh once in the street. He saw dogs who were running in circles, you know, circling each other, you know, endlessly running it. So he said, oh, I can write that into a waltz. And that is a minute waltz, which was turning tamparareira, he described it as dogs running, you know, in circles all the time.
Well, Mr. Rubinstein, Chopin was Polish, and you're Polish. It would seem natural that his approach to music would be closer to you, perhaps, than to some others.
In Poland, they did pick up my understanding of Chopin's music very early. My first success with Chopin was not, as the word usually goes, the prophet, no prophet in his own land. I was the Chopin prophet in my own land first. It was Poland who discovered that my approach to Chopin had something authentic in it. And fortunately, to my great joy, to my great pride, the rest of the world since has taken it up too.
Well, as I said, it seems the most natural thing in the world. You're a Polish pianist playing the works of a Polish pianist.
So that gave me a tremendous link with it. I had to fight very much for my performances of Chopin, because Chopin, being a weak man in his life, he was tuberculous, he died at the age of 39, he had to make his living by lessons, which were paid very well. I mean, he made a good living on that. His pupils were the young countesses and marquises and then duchesses and so on, you know, of the Paris society. There was a Miss Rothschild and all those millionaires, you know, they flattered him, adored him. They worked pretty hard. They played quite well and nicely. But of course, you know that they couldn't have played Chopin as Chopin should be played. So those pupils unfortunately established a sort of tradition which misled a lot of pianists into exaggerating his sentiment, in sentimentalizing tremendously. It came up to my time. I had to fight it with all my power. At the beginning of my life, I was accused of dryness, of the wrong approach to Chopin. They said that it's much too pedestrian, you know, whatever. They insulted me, really, for it.
The prejudgments, the prejudices, they're always the hardest things to change. But you seem to have set the Chopin standard for all the other pianists to shoot at. Tell me, Mr. Rubinstein, do you have maybe a sneaking preference for Chopin's music over that of, say, Beethoven or Bach?
Beethoven wrote lots of things for the piano, but they sound like translations of his ideas, which might have been symphonies or chamber musics or oratorios or songs or whatever you want. And he just treated the piano as a utility to express it in lighter terms, in easier terms rather, easier writing. Schumann, for instance, great composer for the piano. Strangely enough, writing for orchestra, he has written a lot of orchestral works of great importance. His orchestras sound like a piano, but his piano work sounds a little bit like an orchestra. It's a paradox, but it is so. We all discovered it. Mozart and Bach, of course, haven't known the modern piano. They couldn't compete. They might have done the bulk of their work for the modern piano, but they had the harpsichord. Mozart had just a baby beginning of a modern piano toward the end of his life. He couldn't explore it decently. But you see, Chopin was so penetrated by the love of that instrument, he was so linked with it, that he really gave us the best.
I've often wondered why RCA Victor hadn't gotten you to record more Bach, Mr. Rubinstein, since we generally consider him, as you said, the father of modern piano music.
No, I didn't say Bach was the beginner of the piano music. I said, you know, when they asked me very often, newspaper men, you know, who's your favorite in music? It's a rather silly question, because always those championship in anything, you know, there isn't such thing as favorite, because whatever I play is for the moment the only one, not the favorite, but the only one. When I play a concerto of Rachmaninoff, I don't think of any other composer. That doesn't mean that I consider Rachmaninoff the greatest composer. But he becomes the only one when I'm performing him.
But I was wondering why you hadn't recorded Bach. You play him in concerts all the time.
Of course I do, but you see, my approach to Bach is a very strange one, you see. The purists, especially critics, are very up to criticize us in a rather cheap way, I might say. When we play arrangement of the organ fugues in Toccata by a Liszt or Busoni or by ourselves or by anybody else, why doesn't he play the original Bach? There isn't such a thing as the original Bach, because the other one, the not organ Bach, is written for the harpsichord, which again needs a completely different sonority, completely different pedaling. It doesn't really sound right on the piano unless it is transcribed. I wish I were a harpsichordist, then I would play a lot of Bach and record it, but I would never reach probably the mastery of my ex-compatriot Wanda Landowska, who has done marvels with it, of course. Mm-hmm. Supreme master in that field. But I like to play the great organ pieces of Bach, and I did all my life, and I still do.
But Chopin is the one for whom you have a special affinity. Going back a minute to Chopin, the piano teacher, it seems too bad that his pupils weren't the richest in talent, generally, but the richest from the standpoint of cash on hand, like Madame Rothschild of the banking family.
It goes for the other aristocrats, too. There was the Princess Marceline Czartoryska, the Countess such and such, there was the Countess Delphine Potocka. There were all those ladies, you know, French or Greek or whoever lived in Paris, who wanted lessons from Chopin. He was tremendously well known in Paris. He was fashionable.
Well, there are quite a number of dedications among the Chopin waltzes, but from what you say, I imagine these salutes had a practical value. There's only one that bears the name of his great amour, George Sand.
But then there's another waltz which is very, very sentimental, which he has written officially as a love token to his unfortunately not realized fiancée. And I mean, he didn't marry her because The parents were against that marriage, but he did propose marriage to the young Countess Wodzinska. And that was, he was titling to Miss to Mademoiselle Marie. That means, and there's all his love in it. You can trace it, you can feel it. So when I play it, of course, I can't miss, but thinking of Marie Wodzinska, of the sad story, why he didn't get her, and he left a little bundle of her letters with the inscription on it, my unhappiness, my pains. In Polish, it's another word. My poor, I don't know, my unhappiness, let's say. Never mind, it's not the exact word.
You have established the story so well, Mr. Rubinstein. I've been wondering if perhaps albums like this new one, in which you perform so magnificently, might not be making life difficult for rising young pianists. Recordings are so widely disseminated today, people come to expect a certain level of performance which the younger ones do not yet achieve, which is perhaps why the field is so small.
I must say it's quite the contrary, if I may say so. In old times, the young pianists had a very, very hard time because they had no means of publicizing themselves. After all, this business of radio and of television and of gramophone records above all, I mean mostly gramophone records, gives them a tremendous chance of being heard.
I guess it does get them exposure in the United States, which they couldn't any other way.
Look here, America was always a very difficult country, very inaccessible in a way, because they were always conscious of the money possibilities in America, so they defended their ground. It was not easy for a European artist to reach America with a good contract and make money here. It had to be, says somebody, after he's reached the fame, you know that very well, in old times. Well, now, for instance, if a good manager or a good publicizer of gramophone records can bring two or three decent records from somewhere, from Vienna, from Berlin, from any country across, and make a good publicity for it, he becomes suddenly famous overnight.
Well, which comes first, the chicken or the egg? Fame in concert and then a recording contract? Or fame on records and then a concert tour?
That depends, both ways. It has happened this way and the other way.
How about in your own particular case? Of course, you started quite young.
Well, in my case, I must tell you my own case. In old times, I mean my very young, first youth, I mean my 20 years, you know. Well, that was a very hard time for pianists.
Oh, why was that, Mr. Rubinstein?
First of all, we were committed to a season. The season ran from October till April. From April till October, the seasons were dead. We were out of work completely. We had nothing in the world to earn money because all the families who took lessons went to the sea or the mountains or the country or I don't know what for vacations for months to go. There were no concerts because it's too warm. Nobody would dream of going to a concert hall. There was nothing. There were cheap summer concerts in parks or something like that with little bands. I mean, music was completely stopped in April till October. I remember very well that time because we were all dreaming to be invited by a nice family to spend the summer in the country place, you know, to be treated to that and so on, otherwise we would starve. That goes for Chopin too, you know, when he went to the lovely estate of George Sand. It was probably great love and attachment to her, but at the same time, he spent his summer without starving because there were no lessons and there was nothing for him to do.
I think maybe you're being a little unromantic about the great affair, but you think that nowadays Chopin would have had less to worry about than bed and board for the summer?
Nowadays, the thing is completely different because, as you see, that every second day there's a festival of music and they are catering for it like mad and they grow up like mushrooms. There's piano. There are pianist competitions. There are about, I think now, 24 of them in all of the world, and there are no pianists left to take part in them because the best have won already. there are special mothers, you know, being taken care of, you know, to produce the pianist of the next generation for the competitions.
You know, I was wondering how you feel about such things, competitions for artists.
Well, I'm a little bit against it. I think a competition should be a very rare event. Sometimes it can do any good to a pianist, but in very rare cases. Most winners of competitions never go very far. It's an exception. You see, von Kleiben struck the jackpot in Moscow, and he deserved it. That's quite all right, that's fine. Those cases have been once or twice justified. But most of the winners fall into complete obscurity.
But from what I've heard, this sudden oblivion isn't just a question of talent. We know that the politics of the concert field is very important. It's as important to have the right manager as it is to practice the 48 preludes and fugues.
Well, the answer is always the box office. The same thing with books, the same thing with paintings, with everything. What is bought, what is in demand, is the winner. The manager doesn't like to lose his money with a genius for whom he has the deepest respect, but who doesn't make any money. But he will cater very much for a rather lesser fellow who is a colossal attraction to the public. Don't you think so? Unfortunately, it is so. It has always been that way.
Yes, I'm afraid you're probably right, Mr. Rubinstein. In your case, we have the happy combination of both factors. I see by the album cover that this was done abroad, Mr. Rubinstein.
It is a very amusing thing. We recorded it in Rome, and I had two pianos. The company, the Victor company, was very generous about it, and they had two pianos come, one from Naples and one from Florence, because I had used them previously and I loved them. So on my insistence, they got them for me, and they were standing there in that wonderful brand new studio which they have built near Rome. And the best studio in the world, by the way, for recording. All the big operas of the day are made there and so on. Well, I was very happy to go to it, and I had the assignment to make those waltzes for the Dyna Grove, for the modern development and so on. Very happily, what did I find? Both those pianos were in such a shape that they were absolutely impossible to be used. You know. Two tuners came, one especially from Florence, who said that he's the only one entitled to use that piano, to work on that piano, and he was no good. He just put it more out of tune than it was before. I mean, I worked hard on two or three waltzes for 4 days, I think, and no work could come out of it. I mean, they were tuning, it was worse, it sounded dreadfully. I couldn't make it, my technique was not adequate, nothing came off of it and so on. And then my wife had the great idea, seeing my despair after all, to telephone a brilliant, wonderful tuner which we have in Paris, a young boy, a young man, was very keen to come to Rome for the first time in his life to see the Eternal City. So he came right away next morning. Being a very conscientious fellow, he went, before he even looked around Rome, he went to those two pianos, worked them up, and that same night I finished all 14 waltzes in one single session. And the studio was available for me only after a huge, huge session of the opera. I think it was Rigoletto of the Victor Company. I started at 7 in the evening and worked till midnight, and they were all finished.
That's incredible. One straight recording session for all the waltzes?
I never forget that. It was really an inspired session.
And I don't imagine any of the others present will forget it either. When you're all alone with the technicians in a recording studio, Mr. Rubinstein, do you find the lack of an audience makes it difficult for you to work yourself up to performing pitch?
Oh, no. I love recording. I must say, I love recording without an audience. Just it is something, it's a fight with myself. I will not stop a recording unless I feel that I cannot do better for the moment. But if there is the slightest chance to improve on something, I will never give in. I could work 24 hours in succession. I'm the one who never gets tired, never.
This is your reputation. I understand you work engineers and technicians until they're run ragged.
I could bring everybody to his grave, you know, but I'm not tired when it comes to working a record or do something in a movie or something. I mean, a thing like that, undertake an artistic assignment.
I understand that after you recorded this new collection of Chopin waltzes, you didn't even quit after doing the whole thing in one session. You went out and staged a party afterwards.
Not a party. We tried to get drunk on Via Veneto in Rome, but we couldn't succeed because we are very resistant. But just with my friend Wilcox, who helped in doing those records, and my wife and my son, we just went to a cafe and had it till 4 a.m.
There must be some sort of secret for your vitality, something you ought to share. What do you do, for instance, immediately before you play a concert? You seem to arrive on the stage so relaxed, so at ease. You approach your instrument in such a straightforward way. You immediately command the attention of your audience.
It is even dangerous to touch that subject because you might make me self-conscious. This is a thing which I never, never, never could understand what it consists of, where the focus is. I've been called sometimes by critics this great showman, meaning exactly what you just said so flatteringly and so nicely. They said, oh, the great showman in this natural way, he comes up with a quick pace to the piano, sits down upright on the stool and all that sort of thing. Well, I did that when I was 8 years old and 10 years old. I always run like that in the street. I hate to walk with my wife because she makes a smaller pace, you know. I mean, she has another step than I. I like to walk quickly. You know, I mean, it is the most natural thing in the world. I always behave that same way, and there's nothing which I add or plan or do about it. I have no idea of what that consists. I hear lately very much about it, that, oh, the minute you come up and you bow, the public is with you. Well, I will not and cannot understand that. I try to behave quite naturally. I bow seriously to the audience. I don't smile stupidly, you know, to catch their sympathy or something. I do smile when they applaud me very heartily. Well, I would be very ill-bred if I didn't, wouldn't I?
Quite frankly, Mr. Rubinstein, I can't think of any word that applies less. Someone once said that Arthur Rubinstein is the last civilized man, and after having had this chance to share a conversation with him, I would agree most heartily.